In the previous episode, we saw two types of fields, an electric field and a magnetic field. We saw that they have different effects governed by different rules. Let's point out another difference. Say the particle has an initial velocity. It is moving backward along the z-axis. It also has kinetic energy proportional to the velocity squared visualized by this rectangle. The particle is in an electric field pulling it in the opposite direction. So the electric force will at first slow the particle down and decrease its energy, then it will increase it back. Let's play it again and add a measure called power. It tells us the rate at which the kinetic energy changes. Currently, the force decreases the particle's energy, so it has negative power. As the particle momentarily stands still, the power is zero, just before it flips sign and becomes positive. Now the force has positive power. It increases the particle's energy. So electric forces have varying power. Magnetic forces, on the other hand, have zero power. They don't change the particle's energy. Here are the two different fields again. In this episode, we'll see how all these differences can be explained by a change in the coordinate system. So let's now discuss coordinate systems. For simplicity, we use a two-dimensional space in this example. Say we have an observer named Alice. She sees a particle moving with some constant velocity. She can describe the velocity vector using components based on her coordinate system. A second observer, Bob, looks at the same scene from a rotated point of view. Here, the velocity has different components, but both Bob and Alice are observing the same vector. Only their coordinate systems are different. The vector itself exists independently of any coordinate system, as we keep stressing throughout this series. And here's another example. Alice now sees a particle at rest. Bob is moving with a velocity of 0.6 to the left. Here is what Bob sees. He sees a velocity of 0.6 to the right, so now Bob and Alice see different things. Alice sees a vector with zero length. It will remain with zero length no matter how we change the coordinate system. And Bob sees a non-zero vector. So we can't combine these two worldviews into a single diagram, but here's how to fix it. We'll remove the y-axis. We didn't use it in this example anyway. And we'll add a time axis. This is a space-time diagram. The upward movement reflects the passage of time. But the particle remains at the same position on the x-axis, meaning it is not moving in space. Its velocity vector reflects that. The time component is 1, and the x component is 0. The line it traces behind is called a world line. It shows the x position the particle had at each point in time. A vertical world line indicates a particle at rest. And here's what Bob sees. Here the particle moves in space as it moves in time, and its world line is slanted. Let's get back to Alice's diagram. We can now add Bob's point of view to the same diagram using a different coordinate system. X and X prime are the same, but T prime is tilted. From his point of view, the diagram looks like this. Note that we didn't change the diagram, we're just drawing it differently on screen, in accordance with the new coordinate system. Here, the vector has different components, but it's still the same vector. These are just different ways to describe it. This change in coordinate system is called the Galilean transformation. It is used in classical physics. In relativity, there's a different transformation called the Lorentz transformation, where both the x prime and the t prime axes are tilted. But for now, we'll keep using the simpler Galilean transformation. Note that with this transformation, the time component of the velocity vector is always 1. Let's watch another example of the same transformation. Alice sees two moving particles. Bob describes the same objects using a different coordinate system. And everything seems a bit different to him. Now let's take a three-dimensional space. We'll hide the y-axis and add a time axis. This is a four-dimensional space-time diagram with one axis hidden. Here's a particle moving in this diagram. The velocity vector now has 4 components, 3 components defining how it moves in space, and a time component. Note that we cannot see the effect of the y component. If we change it, we get a different vector, but it still looks the same because the y-axis is not shown in this view. So let's gray out this component, and we'll keep it 0 in our examples. To switch to the moving observer, Bob, we'll again use the same transformation. All the axes remain the same except the T prime axis, which is tilted. We are ready now to visualize the electromagnetic tensor in full. It's defined over 2 four-dimensional spaces, so it has a total of 16 components. Before explaining it, let's recall the tensor we used in the previous episode to represent a magnetic field. It was only 3-dimensional. It had no time axis. Let's take this magnetic field. We placed its components at particular matrix elements, and we got a vortex revolving around the magnetic field. It tells us for each particle velocity what force will act on it. For example, if the particle moves to the right, it will be pulled backward. Let's try a magnetic field pointing in another direction. Our arrangement of elements always creates an antisymmetric matrix, and antisymmetric matrices always have this vortex look. Now let's view the full electromagnetic tensor. We can identify the same matrix elements by their blue-red labels and use them in the same way. We got the same vortex again. The reason it looks the same is because in this particular example, we are using only components labeled with X and Z. But here's an arbitrary example. In the bottom diagram, we can see the vortex is tilted in space, but in the top one, we can't because we have hidden the Y-axis. We cannot see any of the tensor's components labeled with a Y. So we'll stick to examples that don't use the grayed-out components. As before, we can interpret this tensor as a map between velocities and forces, only now the velocities always point up because of the time component. This velocity represents a particle that stands still. The vector is pointing in the T direction, so the force mapped to this velocity is defined by the first row of our matrix, the one that is labeled with blue T's. Therefore, the magnetic force is zero, as expected for a particle that is standing still in a magnetic field. And here's a particle moving to the right. For an arbitrary velocity, we need to take a weighted sum of the matrix rows. The velocity components are 1, 1, 0, 0, so the force associated with it is the sum of the first and second rows, the ones labeled with blue T and blue X. And we get the usual magnetic force, pulling the particle backward along the Z-axis. Recall the tensor's map is defined everywhere, not just on the unit sphere. So since our velocities always have a time component of 1, we should really be looking at this slice of the tensor's map, showing the force associated with each possible velocity. Here's a uniform tensor field representing a magnetic field. There's a tensor at every point in spacetime. And here's a particle. It's moving forward along the Z-axis and also up in time as usual. The tensor at its current location maps its velocity to a force. It moves in circles in space as it moves up along the time axis. This tensor can also represent an electric field. A simple way is to place its components here. So here's an electric field pointing in the Z direction. A particle at rest will experience a force specified by the first row of our matrix. And it will experience the same force for all velocities, just as an electric field is supposed to behave. So this works okay, but actually the tensor represents an electric field in a slightly different way. The electric field components are also placed here, negated. Since the matrix is now anti-symmetric, we get again this vortex look. Here's what our plane looks like now. These are still the same forces pulling in the Z direction, only now they have a non-zero time component. This time component represents a quantity we mentioned previously, power, the rate at which this force changes the particle's energy. Only it's negated. Say, for example, the particle moves in the Z direction. The force also pulls in the same direction, causing the particle to accelerate. So it has a positive power given negated in the time component. Now the particle is moving backward, and the force is slowing it down, so it has a negative power. And if the particle is at rest, zero power. We can similarly represent an electric field pointing in other directions. So here's a uniform tensor field representing an electric field. The particle starts at rest. The tensor at its current location maps its velocity to a force pulling it forward along the Z-axis. It accelerates in that direction as it moves up along the time axis. We can see the force remains the same, except its power is gradually increasing. Now let's set the components of the electric field and also the magnetic field. The matrix is still anti-symmetric, so we get a vortex. But now it's tilted. A particle at rest experiences the force specified by the first row, what we usually call an electric force. Now say it moves forward. The velocity components are now 1, 0, 0, 1, so the resulting force is the sum of the first and last rows. The last row contributes the magnetic force, adding this tilt to the right. Also, it adds the time component with the power of the electric force. The single force given by the tensor is now the combined effect of both fields. And here's our plane. We can see the general pull forward due to the electric field with the tilting effects caused by the magnetic field. Here's a particle flying through such a field. Initially, it experiences a pull forward, then its path starts to bend to the right. Let's project its path onto the XZ plane, and now run the simulation again using the older terminology. We have the Y axis again, and the electric and magnetic fields that are equivalent to the tensor field. The particle now flies along the same path under the influence of two forces. We can now see that the electric and magnetic fields are not so different from each other. The same object can be either or both, depending on how it's oriented in space-time. If it lies flat on the XZ plane, it's a magnetic field, causing circular motion with zero power. If it's upright, it's an electric field, causing motion towards a particular direction with varying power. In between it is a mix of both. Not only can this object play different roles, but different observers will interpret it differently depending on their coordinate system. To fully explain how this works requires delving deeper into both math and physics, and specifically the theory of relativity. But let's start in a simplified way. Say Alice sees this tensor. It represents an electric field. Bob is looking at the same tensor, but using a different coordinate system. How is this tensor going to appear to Bob? This is a mathematical question. We saw in previous episodes that if he had a rotated coordinate system, he would have seen the tensor rotated, representing now also a magnetic field. Our case is a bit more complicated. He has a coordinate system with a skewed axis. How this affects a tensor requires some more explanations, and we'll get to it later. For now, we'll assume it has a similar effect. It rotates the tensor a little. So let's add a mark that the demonstrations we'll see next are simplified and demonstrate how things work in principle. They will be simplified also because we're skipping some concepts from relativity. We'll explain at the end how to make this transformation accurate. Let's start with the older terminology. This is an ordinary 3D space without a time axis. We see a particle in an electric field. It accelerates because of the electric force and passes through a hoop. This is what Alice sees. Before we see Bob's point of view, let's switch to the new terminology. We'll hide the y-axis and add a time axis. This is the tensor field that represents the electric field. Now let's switch to Bob. He sees the same tensor field, but to him it looks different. These tilted vortices represent a combination of electric and magnetic fields. Back to Alice. Here's the particle accelerating and flying through the hoop, as viewed using a space-time diagram. Its world line intersects that of the hoop, meaning it passed through it. Now let's switch to Bob again. All these objects exist in space and interact with each other independently of the coordinate system. So Bob sees essentially the same thing, a particle flying under the influence of a tensor field and passing through a hoop. But according to the old terminology, he has a very different explanation as to why that happens. To him, the particle flies under the influence of two fields, and these force vectors are not just electric forces, but the sum of both electric and magnetic forces. And here's a second example. Again, we start with the older terminology. This is a particle at rest. So far, we've seen how this particle is influenced by electromagnetic fields, but it also generates one itself. A particle at rest generates an electric field. Now let's remove the y-axis and add a time axis. The electric field is now represented by a tensor field. We can see all the vortices are upright and their upper parts point away from the particle. Now let's switch to Bob. He sees a moving particle and also the tensor field looks different. Let's focus first on these two tensors. They rolled on their own axis of symmetry, so their appearance didn't change. But now let's focus on these two. They rolled on their side, so a magnetic field showed up here. Let's return to the older terminology view. The particle has a non-zero velocity now. The magnetic field vectors we see on the XZ plane are part of rings surrounding the particle's path. Exactly what we'd expect from a moving charged particle. Except we got them flipped because we didn't transform the tensors exactly right. Now let's explain how to do that accurately. We need to start distinguishing between different types of tensors, something we haven't discussed so far. They all look the same in this view. If we switch to a rotated coordinate system, they still look the same. But to changes other than rotations, each of them responds differently. We'll explain how and why in the next episodes. This is the type we used so far. But for the physics to work, we need to use relativity, and specifically the Lorentz transformation. Here's what it looks like. The vortex tilted in the opposite direction, as anticipated by the last demonstration.